They stop cell growth, and they can be used for possibly for treating tumors. Or you're secreting a compound that will prevent predators from eating you, prevent microbes from fouling the outside of you, or will protect you from ultraviolet radiation if you're in shallow water. Now, because most of these compounds come from essentially shallow water invertebrates and mainly on coral reefs, there's been some suggestion in the literature right now that there's probably a collection bias and that these tend to be things that are easy to collect by divers in nice warm water on coral reefs. So that's where most of the collection effort is being made. Oops. And there may be similar compounds that are found in others, areas that are less easy to access or less comfortable to be diving in. Here's a global map showing us a distribution of some of these compounds just in coastal waters. And you can see two concentrations. One in areas where there are a lot of corals, for example, the famous coral triangle here in the South Pacific, in some in the Caribbean, but also really strong concentrations around the highest numbers here around Japan, completely surrounding Australia and North America, and a little bit off. So this is where research institutions are doing this kind of work. This does not really reflect the fact that Australia has more compounds than neighboring islands here. This is just where we're looking right now. Here's an example of some drugs, and this dates back to 2006, but the point I want to make here is these are drugs now that are undergoing clinical trials, and the activity we're looking at, see, most of these are anti-cancer drugs, and there are a few that are anti-asthmatic, and one for Alzheimer's and one for pain. Now, what's interesting is what we're doing for the clinical trials, the supply of drugs for the clinical trials in almost every one of these is synthetic. So that means we've taken a marine organism, we've sampled it, we've identified a compound, and now when we move to the next stage, we don't have to go out into the environment and harvest a whole bunch more biomass. We synthesize this molecule in the lab and use that from then on. So the organism in the environment just serves for the discovery phase of this. And then after that, we figure out how to make it ourselves with synthetic chemistry, and off we go from there. Here's one example I wanted to share with you, is Yondelis, which is being marketed by a Spanish company called Pharmamar, which is an anti-tumor agent that was discovered in this squishy-looking animal here. It's now been approved in 57 countries for treatment of difficult ovarian cancers. So there are some successes here, even though, as you can see, the process is long and it's very costly. So let's get back to hydrothermal vents now that we've got this global context. And I'm going to talk about two cases of genetic resources at hydrothermal vents that are of interest. One are the extreme enzymes. Remember, a lot of these organisms living at vents live at high temperatures, which means that chemical reactions happen faster because molecules are moving faster. And one of these enzymes is called the polymerase enzyme. This is an enzyme that we use for making multiple copies of DNA for things like DNA fingerprinting or doing genome mapping. Originally, so this is about a $500 million a year global market. And right now, 30% of the sales are from these two polymerase enzymes that come from bacteria from hydrothermal vents. The other one is the TAC enzyme here that comes from a hydrothermal pool in Yellowstone Park in the western U.S., where this organism here, bacteria called Thermus aquaticus, was discovered in the 1940s. And then 45 years later, we found a use for one of its enzymes. So it can be a long process again. But once we knew that, we were much more quick to actually exploit the enzymes from the hydrothermal vent organisms. That was only about 5 or 10 years. So that's one example, a clean example. Another one, instead of enzymes, I look at some of the novel biomolecules. And here I've got a kind of a convoluted story to tell you here. It all started off with, remember the tube worm that we were talking about earlier? And this tube worm has a transportation problem. It has to take these three molecules into its blood and move them down to where the bacteria live. And one problem is keeping hydrogen sulfide and oxygen, keeping them separate in the blood so they don't react in the animal's blood before they get to their destination. And they do this with a very unusual hemoglobin molecule. So hemoglobin is the molecule we all have in our red blood cells that serves to transport oxygen. So a group of French researchers started doing some very intensive research on the tubeworm hemoglobin, and they suddenly became world experts. They had a laboratory that could study worm hemoglobin from all sorts of animals. And this then spun off into essentially some clinical trials now where we're actually using producing artificial human blood from marine worms. Why would we want artificial blood? There are all sorts of problems related to blood transfusions, many blood-borne diseases that cause all sorts of issues. And if we could find a substitute for blood transfusions, we would be doing the health system globally a great service. And one of the most important things your blood needs to do is to transport oxygen when you're recovering from surgery. That is the most critical thing. And it also carries around your immune system and moves waste around. But in the 48 hours after you've had a blood loss after surgery or an accident, what you need to replace immediately is your capacity to move gases around. And you can do that if you just had water with some other kind of hemoglobin in it. So this is the interest in worm hemoglobin because it's not attacked by the human immune system. So they started this research, they developed this expertise, they connected with the biotechnology industry, and now they're manufacturing this blood hemoglobin to clinical trials. And they're doing this working with a company called Seabait. So this company actually raises marine worms for fishing. So if you want to get some worms and go catch a fish, they raise them on sewage sludge. So now they originally started this project by taking kilos and kilos of worms, grinding them up in a big machine, squishing out their blood, and then doing these hemoglobin purifications with it. What we're doing now is they have actually transferred the gene from the hemoglobin gene to E. coli. So now we have a bacteria that makes the hemoglobin molecule. We don't have to kill any worms. And this is where they're at with clinical trials. So they're doing things like taking mice and giving them partial transfusions of this artificial blood made from the worms. And they're following their growth over 20 weeks. And they're doing just fine. The mice are anyway. So that's the biotechnology potential. I hope I've shown you that there are a couple of interesting examples that give us hints about the potential. And then some of the other things I want to talk about just briefly here as I wind up are the value of this hydrothermal faunas to the marine scientific research and also for public education. MSR really is a major stakeholder in this environment. This is a really unusual environment. It's attracted some of the best scientific minds in the world. This is a hundreds of millions of dollars a year industry in terms of scientific salaries, ships, and submersibles. Has been like this for 20 years. So this group is there's just so many strange and interesting things happening in this environment biologically and even in terms of the geology that this is really the only stakeholder for the moment. And also public education. An environment like this is a great showcase for essentially teaching the general public how the Earth works, how plate tectonics works, how we can have life in hostile environments. And there are a number of things like this IMAX film here, Volcanoes of the Deep Sea, that I was involved in about 10 years ago now. What I want to finish off now is telling you a little bit about a marine protected area at the Endeavour hydrothermal vents. This is a marine protected area off the west coast of Canada here. This is the Endeavour hydrothermal vents. So this is the Seattle and Vancouver here in the North Pacific. This area was set aside as a marine protected area in 2003, exclusively as a reserve for scientific research. And now we've just cabled the site so that now we are able to do direct monitoring using the Neptune Canada cabled observatory. So there's a cable that runs out from Vancouver Island, 800 kilometers out to the ridge, and then back again. And this cable supplies power and communications to instruments at the hydrothermal vents, and we're able to monitor of the site indirectly, both with cameras, seismometers, temperature sensors in the hydrothermal fluids. We've just put the first instruments in last fall. There's an expedition going out in July to complete the installation of these instruments. So about 4 or 5 months from now, we'll be able to go online and see hydrothermal vents in action. So this is the first time we've been able to do continuous monitoring like this. It'll be available on the internet to anyone who wants to have a look at it. All right, thank you very much for your attention.
Questions for Dr. Juniper?
Okay, that's better. My name is Simon Bowell from Ocean Floor. We are going to invest in deep sea mining. I was very interested in your presentation of the hydrothermal vents, but these are all active hydrothermal vents where all the organisms take their energy from the chemical compounds coming out of the earth. We also have studies on non-active hydrothermal vents, the old ones that have no diet. Is there life too over there, or is it sterile? Do you know about?
Oops, I did have a slide for that, but we don't really know. There are two features of the older, the inactive sites. Some of them are very old. And what's attractive about the very old hydrothermal vent sites is, from the mining point of view, they tend to have bigger deposits because they've been depositing minerals for a longer period of time. From the ecological point of view, that also means that they've been accumulating species for a longer period of time. So it's a bit like the Amazon or the deep. So if they're still active, they may be a special case. In terms of the extinct deposits, there hasn't been very much research done on the ecosystems that may live on them. We know that, for example, some of the extinct chimneys are colonized by normal deep-sea corals and sponges, and but we're not completely certain that there is no organisms living on there that are not dependent on the deposit for something other than just being something solid to sit on. For example, if the deposits are exposed to seawater for a very long time, they start to oxidize. And there are a number of bacteria that actually speed up this oxidation process, and some animals that eat these bacteria. So we may get some very slow growth of maybe not specialized organisms, in which case it's not a worry, but we do need to do more investigation of what goes on at these extinct deposits. But they don't attract much research because they're not exotic. There's no black smoke coming out of the seafloor, and it's called the Disneyland effect, where people go straight to the exotic ones and think, oh, that's boring. I'm not going to spend my research money working on this dead deposit. If I'm a biologist, I might not find anything, which means I would fail. So, a year and a half ago now, there was a meeting at Woods Hole, this mining discussion, and a group pointed out that we should start looking at these extinct deposits to be absolutely certain that there's no problem, no complexity mining these things.
What's the time frame for lava recruitment?
It can be very fast. We've learned that from a couple of things. When some hydrothermal vents, both on the East Pacific Rise and north off Vancouver Island, were wiped out by undersea volcanic eruptions, they were recolonized within months from we don't know where, but certainly from the surrounding area. So this is an ecosystem that's adapted to a dynamic environment. So they produce a lot of larvae. They have a lot of capacity to grow very fast, and reproduce, and recolonize.
Next speaker will be discussing the International Seabed Authority's geologic model polymetallic nodule deposits in the CCZ and what we contain in the way of data in the central data repository here. Speaker is Dr. Vijay Kodagali. He is a senior scientific affairs officer for the International Seabed Authority in the field of marine geology.
Thank you, Chairman. Good afternoon, delegates. And today, I'll be talking on the data and information to administer the mineral resources of the area. Actually, I would like to split my talk into two parts. The first one is on the central data repository, which is the basis from which we started working. Actually, the Secretary General mentioned about the data and repository, central data repository yesterday. I'll talk a little bit more about that, what we have, and how we got into this. The three main resources, as has been told repeatedly here already, the polymetallic nodules, the cobalt-rich crust, and the polymetallic sulfides. Our objective of this central data repository was to collect and centralize all public and private data and information on marine mineral resources, which should be accessible to all member states, should display the acquired data and information, and display data in various forms, listings, graphs, maps, and develop an integrated database system for use as a management and research tool for both administrators and researchers. Prior to this, the situation was that large quantity of data collected and was known to exist, but dispersed widely among various organizations and companies worldwide. It was in different formats, in different standards, not readily accessible to potential users. So we are trying to bridge that gap and provide information in one under one roof. We approached, as Secretary General mentioned yesterday, 18 different organizations for our data, and we could collect data from these different sources. As I said, we have inventory of three data resources as of now available. For polymetallic nodules, we have a sample data set containing about 2,753 samples, which has a geochemical data set which relates to location, depth, and geochemical analysis for over 60 elements, including the method of analysis, etc. Then there is a separate major element data set, which is similar to the geochemical data set, but it is limited for the nine major elements, which constitute 90% of the material for the deep sea nodules, that is AlCOs, copper, iron, manganese, nickel, lead, zinc, and silicon. These are, I think this map was also shown by the Secretary General of Comrade in the morning, the polymetallic nodule locations in the central data repository. As you can see, this is the main area in the Pacific where I will also talk about the modeling studies which we carried out in the Clarion-Clipperton Zone later. Actually, if you see, there are a lot of locations where more data may be available, but it's limited in our data repository as of now. Somebody was asking about the data in the Caribbean region. Unfortunately, there are no nodules reported in these regions. There are, in fact, no other known deposits of, say, sulfides or the cobalt crust also in the Caribbean region. As far as the cobalt-rich crust are concerned, we have a data set consisting of about 3,500 samples. Also has a geochemical data set and a major element data set similar to what we have in the other deposits. This is the map showing the locations where the cobalt-rich crust locations in the central data repository. The third type of deposits which we have in our data repository are the polymetallic sulfides. We started collecting this data in 2001 and 2. Then we had a limited data set available. Last year, in 2009, we augmented this data set, and now we have more than 2,600 data sets available for the hydrothermal vent sulfides. These are the locations of the sulfide location, sulfide deposits in the central data repository. We also have the biological data set in our central data repository. My colleague Mr. Cook will talk about this later in much more details. We have this is a new data set which we have tried to put it into our central data repository. The total amount of biological data available is listed separately in another table. Each occurrence of biological sample is noted as a separate record, and hence a single location is listed several times. These are the locations where we have the biological data. The three types of data: abyssal plane biology, cement biology, and the hydrothermal vent biology. Considering the data which has been presented earlier by Kim and others, the amount of data which we hold in the central data repository as far as the biological data is concerned is much less, and we are trying to augment that. This is a summary of the data which we have in our data repository. For nodules, 2,700, for cobalt-rich crusts, about 3,500, and now for sulfides, a total of 6,000 records. And these are the other details about the data which we have. We also have the biological data, as you can see, vent biology, cement biology, and the main source for these data are the Kaplan projects and the contractors, the Siemens online data as far as the cobalt rich crusts are concerned, and the CHIS data as far as the sulfides are concerned. What is the use of having the data if it cannot be used properly by the users? So we have provided a more flexible, dynamic online database query system, wherein you can select subsets based on the location, the latitude, longitudes, or the geographic zones, then elements of abundance, cruise ID, etc. Based on that, you can select the data, whichever data you want. You can pick the data and get data within a particular geographical zone. Actually, we also have a web GIS, which is now on our website. You can see that. Unfortunately, presently, at this time, it's not working because we are trying to shift to a new and improved server. It's not working, but within a week, we will be putting this up again. This web GIS is an integral part of Online Atlas, a web geographical information system which accommodates secretariat's geographical information on the area and the regions of potential outer continental shelf. Map interface allows for interactive mapping of the for external users, aims to enable the and disseminate available data on resource potential as well as other physical, political, and environmental information. The objective of this web GIS is to map mineral resource distributions in the area, integrate additional information from various sources, and compile a holistic, multidisciplinary seabed geographical information system. Includes bathymetry, maritime boundaries, geological structures, biogeography, sediments, and areas of other interest. Make the spatial information accessible through an interactive World Wide Web interface. Contribute data and maps to the United Nations Atlas of the Oceans, and create visualization and analysis capabilities to support research and decision making. Presently, the following information can readily be accessed using the interactive web GIS tool: deposit occurrences, locations in the central data repository, ocean floor features such as seamounts, ridges, trenches, basins, easier limits which we have we had earlier, but then we have the biological data, the world seas, surfacial sediments and sediment thickness, bathymetric contours, and thymetic maps. In addition to the biological data and the three main resource data, we also have a patent database in our central data repository. We did conduct a survey of international patents to identify trends in development of deep seabed mining, which was actually limited to 1960 to 1998. This is mostly related to the polymetallic nodule exploitation. Surveys resulted in the identification of 352 patents in 12 patent systems. In 1983 was the peak with 34 patents for that year, and after that the pace reduced subsequently. 85% of the patents come from USA, Japan, and the former Russian, and two searchable CD-ROMs we have produced, which are there on our central data repository. They contain patents grouped in 10 volumes and as many sub-volumes according to the design concepts. Database is fully implemented in the CDR and can be viewed with Adobe Reader. We also have a restricted database, which is a Polydate, we call. It has a data repository of the reserved area submitted by the contractors. But this is not open to the general public. It's only because it's only to be used by the authority. It's reserved and it's used only by us. Its framework is available in coordinate systems, again topography, and the 2,335 station data, which is the data was provided by the contractors along with the submission of the applications for their approval of the plans of the work. Secretariat of Technologists, having received data from the following institutions, NOAA, the USGS, IOM, Geological Survey of Canada, COMRA, IFREMAR, Republic of Korea, DOD, InterReg, and other public domain. In the future, we would try to excel and update our CDR with new data sources from the public domains, request contractors and other member states to provide any other non-proprietary data in addition to what we presently have in the central data repository. More biological data to be collected from different sources, continue to develop more robust central data repository with better graphic interfaces, searchable database, and more user-friendly options, link CDR to Google Earth, continuously update the bibliographic database, refine the patent searchable database, and update the patent database to include more recent patents, extend CDR to include maps, photographs, video galleries, update CDR with data and results from geological model of the polymetallic nodule, which we have completed. I will be talking about this in detail later. Strive to establish a museum of marine mineral resources. The part two of my talk will concentrate on the development of the geological model and a prospect guide for polymetallic nodules in the Clarion-Clipperton zone. We started with the data, which I showed already. But as you could see, we have large area of in the Clarion-Clipperton zone where all but one of our contractors have their areas. They have also provided the data to us. So based on that, we thought that it is fit to model that big area and come up with a resource evaluation and a model for the development of the resources in that area. The program objectives were to improve Clarion-Clipperton resource assessment, integrate available resources and related environmental data, and provide useful guidelines for prospecting and exploitation for future prospectors in other areas. The area of interest is 110 degree to 160 degree and 0 to 20 degree north. As you can see, such a huge area. It's in fact, for the first time in the world, I think, that we have such a big contiguous area which has been modeled for the resources. In fact, the legal counsel in the morning showed how big this area is. It can be fitted into the United States of America, and compared to other nations, it's such a huge area. In fact, just to sail from one end of the area to the other end, it takes about 12 to 15 days without doing any work, just to sail, it takes that much of time. So it's such a huge area. We have tried to model based on the available data. This map has been shown again repeatedly since yesterday, the location of the contractors areas and the reserved areas in the clear and Clipperton zone. So what prompted us to model this area is because we had data available from the contractors and in the reserved area which was provided by the contractors, and then we approached the contractors again if they could provide us with any additional data so that we can work on and generating a model for this. The program team consisted of three parts. The secretariat, where we try to coordinate with the consultants and the contractors. Main data was provided by the contractors. Then we had picked up certain consultants from different contractor areas and from independent areas who worked for our development of the program. Secretariat acted as a coordinator for all this. So we had collected data from the contractors, provided to consultants. Consultant provided the reports which we put on our website. The major schedule of milestones. This program, in fact, commenced in right earnest in 2006, and we finished everything in 2009, and the reports are being published. In fact, they are all there in the form of CD on the website, but a published book will be out within a couple of weeks' time. It's in the press now. So work started with draft reports in July, then mid-course meeting wherein we tweaked our requirements, and then we produced interim reports again in 2007 and 8, final reports in early 2009. And review of the documents was done by the external reviewers, not part of our consultants, which was done in June 2009. And a final workshop was held in December 2009, wherein the results were published. We set up a secured file transfer protocol and a virtual private network site, which was accessible only to the consultants and the contractors as far as this project on the geological model development was concerned. The bathymetric data from the public domain, additional data acquired from contractors for geological model program, data and reports submitted by the consultants, and digitization and georeferencing of bathymetric maps provided by the earlier pioneer universities were all put on this FTP site, which was accessible only to the consultants and the contractors. We divided the data collection into the proxy data and the resource data. The proxy data included the bathymetry, the tectonic and the volcanic data, the sediment data, morphology data for the nodules, water column data, and the biological data. And the resource data included the abundance and the chemical analysis for manganese, nickel, copper, and cobalt. In addition to the data which I showed in this EDR, we, as I said, we approached the contractors if they could provide us with any additional data. And the success of the geological model program is basically because a lot of data was provided by our other contractors from the areas belonging to them and also the other areas which they had worked earlier. So we had the data for the nodules from Komora, from Korea, and from the interocean metals, gravity and magnetic data, meteorological data, CTD data, bathymetric data, again sediment types data, particle size data, and deep photographic data, mostly coming from all these contractors. In addition, Japan provided us with 1450 data points of Mn to Fe ratio data, and the Ifremer provided 500 stations, nodule abundance, grade data for validation, and also for the sediments. We had two major tasks as far as the geological model was concerned. two documents to come out. One is a prospector's guide, and the other was the geological model itself. The prospector's guide used several proxies, such as the gridded bathymetry, volcanic and tectonic data, growth model for polymetallic nodules, nodule coverage, morphology, distribution in eastern Clarion-Clipperton zone, sediments in the eastern Clarion-Clipperton zone, nodule genesis and sediment distribution in the Korean area, bathymetry and sediments in the Komura area, regional examination of the sediments and benthic biological data from the Clarion-Clipperton zone. As you can see, some of the data because was provided by only by the contractors in their areas. So, we had more data available in those areas. So, we could model, we could concentrate more on those areas, whereas for general resource evaluation, we used the entire data. The bathymetric map of the Clarion-Clipperton zone, we started with the public domain data, the e-topo data, the 1 inch, 1 minute depth data. Then we had the data sets provided by the different contractors, which we georeference and data digitized and put it in our original database so that we could update the map for the bathymetry of the Clarion-Clipperton zone. Then we made a 1 minute bathymetry data based on the data which was available in the public domain, which was georeferenced and digitized from the contractors' data, and also some of the additional data which was provided by Komura and Cordy. As far as the tectonics and volcanism is concerned, in fact, this is for the first time that we gathered the data on the tectonics and volcanism in the entire Clarion-Clipperton zone. This was worked by one of our consultants who was also collected all the data from the for the faults, the fracture zones, and all the available tectonic data in that, and a tectonic map of the area was generated. Sediment facies and the nodule abundance in the area, the data was generated using the data which was made available by the contractors and also the data which is available in the public domain. We could with all the data we could find that this is a thick line you can see here, the black dashed line, which is the actual maximum for the nodule abundance. So, this is the area we found that where we have a maximum nodule abundance in the Clarion-Clipperton zone. Based on the tectonic data and the volcanic data, we also had a reconstruction of the Clarion-Clipperton zone over 20 million years from the present. We had prepared maps, in fact, I am not presenting here, but we also have maps for 20 million years, 15 million years, 10 million years and 5 million years, which you can see on our the published and records of the geological model. Then we use the nodule morphology as the data. This data mainly uses the based on the 926 station data provided by Interocean Metal, is one of the contractors. The discoidal type of nodules dominate, and the distribution of nodule types shows a zonality. You can see that the different types of nodules which we have, the S type or the smooth type, the rough type and the smooth and rough type nodules, and we see that a certain type of nodules dominate in certain type of topographical environment, and this modeling was done based on the data which we acquired from different contractors. The six factors necessary for nodule growth are the supply of metals, the presence of nucleus, Antarctic bottom water, semi-liquid surface layer, bioturbation and internal stratigraphy. The histogram showing the genetic nodule types in the eastern Clarion-Clipperton zone can be seen here. You can see that based on that, we have the D type of the nodules dominating in the region. Then histograms of nodule morphological types, you can see that again in the D types of nodules here dominate. Abundance and nodule coverage versus water depth. Can see this table shows that depending on the data which we had in different depth ranges, the number of stations were the nodule coverage and the nodule abundance in kilograms per square meters. As I mentioned earlier, Komra provided detailed bathymetric and sediment data for in the two areas, in the east area and the west area. This was also presented by Komra in the morning. This is the detailed bathymetric map of the west area. Then similarly, we also produced, we had requested the consultant from Komra to produce a sediment distribution map for the two areas, and these are the two sediment distribution maps provided by Komra. The next proxy which we used was in the water column is the carbonate compensation depth. So, we based on the available data, one of our consultants generated a isobath of clear carbonate compensation depth. In fact, it was based on the data which you can see here, the black spots. These are the areas from where we could get the carbonate compensation depth data in the region. And based on that, a map was prepared. And because water column data, the carbonate compensation depth is one of the major factors where which will influence the distribution of the nodules. Based on the mid-summer analysis of our data, we thought that it's better to use water column data minus the carbonate compensation depth data as a control for the nodule distribution. Here you can see that if the carbonate compensation depth is more than water depth, and this is the area where it is less. So, where we find the nodules are the areas which is in this region where it is just below the carbonate compensation depth. As you can see, depth minus CCD is between 0 to 500 meters. That is where all the nodule deposits were found in our region. The other proxy which we used for in the development of the prospector's guide was the biological data. Unfortunately, we didn't have much of the data which was made available to our consultant. So, we don't have much to talk about as far as the biological data is concerned. The benthic faunal abundance trend surface planes were generated for different different types of species. Then we also could generate a nitrogen export flux and the carbon export flux for the Clarion-Clipperton zone. But unfortunately, we were constrained by less number of station data as far as this is concerned. So, the first part of the prospector's guide was using these proxies. We should be able to guide a future prospector to go to which area and which of the data which he should look for if he has to search for a good nodule deposit. Then the second part was a geological model. So, in this model, what we did was we used a primary data source, then we inferred the data resources, and then we did a modeling based on the spatial decision support system. The data sets used were different. We had a data set provided by Korea using the geostatistical statistical and GIS techniques. Then the biogeochemical approach to modeling, examining the use of specific proxy variables to predict deposit characteristics where data are lacking. Then finally, the spatial decision support system approach to the modeling, which employs weights of evidence modeling, fuzzy logic, logistic regression, and artificial neural network techniques based on some proxy variables. Next, Rupe. Yeah. Yeah, these are the sample stations which we use for the resource assessment, actual sample stations which were available for us for the resource assessment. This data, this table shows the data which we used for after screening, the data available from the CDR, that is our data repository provided by Korea. This is the data from OMCO, which one of our consultant could manage to get, then data provided by COMRA and the Inter-Ocean Metals. So as far as the abundance, that is the as kilograms per square meter of nodules on the seafloor, we had about 61,000 station data, most of that coming from COMRA from the multi-frequency exploration system. Then we had the chemical analysis from manganese, cobalt, nickel, and copper. In fact, for our resource assessment, we used only for these four metals because we had data from most of the areas for these stations only. As you can see, we had the chemical analysis for about 8,000 stations for manganese, for cobalt, for nickel and copper, whereas the abundance data for a lot more stations. This summary resources means the average of in the entire Clarion-Clipperton zone, which amounts to about 12 million square kilometers of area. The mean abundance is about 5.58. The mean manganese percentage is 1.51. Cobalt is 0.012. Nickel is 0.07. Copper is this much, the median. And the total tonnage, which we calculated, in fact, I will come to this later. You can see there at the bottom. That is for the entire Clarion-Clipperton zone area. You can see that the means are very less here because there are a lot of areas which are not sampled properly in this. See, we use four these methods for resource inferring the resources. The total reduced area 3.83. We have nodules of 21,000 million metric tons. Then manganese is this much, cobalt, nickel, and copper. From the biological model, we had that is the amount which you can find for the nodules. Then from the potential resources of the nodules, in the total 12.57 million square kilometers of the area, these many nodules, 62,000 million metric tons. Then estimated tons of manganese is this much, and cobalt is 134, nickel is 761, and copper of 669. So it is a huge amount of resources which we are talking about in this area. The blocks used in the study, as far as this is the second part of study which we used, which Korean consultants had carried out. We used the ordinary Krieging method and sequential indicator simulation for five areas which you just saw. So you can see that there are five blocks which we are here. So these five blocks were modeled separately and the resources were evaluated for block 1, 2, 3 and then for the total area using the ordinary Krieging method and the sequential indicator simulation. So the total amount of area which we calculated based on for these areas is 23 million square kilometers in these four blocks only. So this is actually this modeling was limited to the area where the samples were available. Then we had a biogeochemical modeling. This model represented predicts the geographical distribution of nodule metals content, manganese, copper, nickel, cobalt, and nickel concentrations and abundance, using as model components the values, among others, known variables, including chlorophyll concentrations in the surface waters, distance from the East Pacific rise, and the carbonate compensation depth. Based on the biogeochemical modeling, we have a mean abundance of 5.58 kilograms per square meter. The manganese is 1.51, cobalt is this much, nickel and copper, as we have already indicated earlier. The tonnage calculated from this estimation is shown here. The general hypothesis for the development is the source of metal comes from land and the East Pacific rise carried in suspended sediments. Sediments are consumed by zooplankton and converted to larger pellets that sink, and the fecal pellets are metabolized by benthic fauna, releasing the reduced metals, and the reduced metals are scavenged by manganese oxide surface waters. So, that is how you finally find that this is the region from where the supply comes when we have the deposits in this region. So, this is a general model for the development of the nodules. The proxy variables used in this study are the distance from the East Pacific rise, then the chlorophyll content of the surface waters. As far as the chlorophyll content is concerned, this is closely related to the level of biological activity taking place and also to the export productivity at the site. In this study, we used the estimates of chlorophyll content that were determined by blending historical archives in situ, National Oceanographic Data Center and satellite data, which were combined using the blended analysis method of Reynolds 1988. It is an attempt to construct an improved climatological seasonal representation of global chlorophyll distribution. These data are available as seasonal and annual averages. So, then the other data was the distance from the carbonate composition depth. Chlorophyll in the surface water, this is the map produced from that. It is really amazing that the present day chlorophyll has, based on that, you could generate now water depth, the distribution maps for the manganese, nickel, cobalt and copper. This is the map showing the water depth minus the carbonate composition depth in the Clarion-Clipperton zone. These are the maps which we generated using the biogeochemical modeling. This is for the cobalt model prediction. This is for the nickel model prediction, which goes fairly well with what we found from the actual data. This is the model prediction for the copper and that for the manganese. Finally, we had a spatial decision support system. As I said, this is a artificial intelligence method for modeling the resources. This study is based on data sets compiled by other experts that include bathymetry, topography, sediment type, carbonate compensation depth, surface chlorophyll, specific techniques such as that we used in the SDSS modeling, where weights of evidence modeling, fuzzy logic, logistic regression, and artificial neural network techniques. I am not going to show much detail about that, but these are the maps which we generated using the different methods. This is for the logical regression method, this is for the fuzzy logic, and this is for the other method. So, these three methods, in fact, we tried to predict the nodule abundances and the grade. The workshop was held in December 2009, wherein the results of the projects were presented to the international community. This was held in Kingston. Based on that, we have produced a technical study, which is already there on the website, and we are going to publish it within a couple of weeks. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. It's now just a couple of minutes after 1 o'clock, and I was looking at this afternoon's schedule and seeing how I'm the one sitting in this chair, and I have the boss next to me. We've decided that we're going to shorten lunch by a half hour, and so we would like to begin again at 2:30, and that in effect will get us out of here by 5:15 tonight instead of 5:45 tonight. So everything on your schedule will be pushed up a half hour this afternoon. Thank you very much. Enjoy your lunch.